Coming up, as more of your users build Power Platform experiences around company data and processes, we're going to take a look at the controls that you have in IT to manage environments, monitor across your tenant, as well as secure data access and more. So today I'm joined by Julie Strauss, who's a director of the admin and governance team for the Power Platform. Welcome to the show.
It's great to be here, Jeremy. Thanks for having me.
And thanks for joining us remotely today. So low-code environments, such as with Microsoft's Power Platform, have really now become more and more prolific. Power Automate, for example, is one of the most popular automation platforms now on the planet, with around 25 billion process flows running every day. And Power Apps are also super popular, as we saw with things like Team Rubicon's use of Power Apps, as well as pharmaceutical company GSK's implementation that we had recently on Microsoft Mechanics. Now, there's a huge momentum that we're seeing with around 3 million active makers of Power Apps every single month, which is all great for business users and citizen developers and pro developers. But what does this then mean for IT?
It's great for those of you in IT too. There's no reason why you can't let your citizen and pro developers innovate and automate their business processes and create apps. And you might be familiar with the controls we have available for Power BI, which I know we have shown a few times here on Microsoft Mechanics. But we also have controls for the rest of the Power Platform that helps you focus on making sure that you have the right parameters in place for those creating apps and flows. And this is what we are going to be talking about today.
Okay, so why don't we start from the top here? And a lot of time you think about the extent of the activity that's going on in your organization. You want to get a handle on that from an IT perspective of the apps, the flows, and all the policies that you might need to set. What do you need to do then from an IT perspective to know which policies to set?
Well, we've been doing a lot of work in the area of administration and governance, including analytics, to make it much easier to oversee what apps are being created, by whom, and the impact to the rest of the organization. The new Power Platform Admin Center provides a unified management experience, which you can get to by going to admin.powerplatform.microsoft.com. And from there, you can access a number of built-in reports. I'll point out a few of the important ones. Under resources, for example, you can access capacity reporting where you can assess the storage consumption for your tenant. You can see which type of storage is being consumed, as well as which environments are consuming it. So you can very closely monitor who are the heavy consumers in your environments. Next, let's take a look at analytics. Under Power Automate, you can see what processes are being automated and which flows are being created. And with it, you can here have a different view into the runs being made daily, weekly, as well as monthly. And this is useful when you want to see how active your user community is. You can also quickly see which data sources makers are connecting to and who is using them and in which flows. And you can get the same for apps. This is useful when you think through your data loss prevention policies and who have permissions to connect to specific data sources. This can also give you a feel for the impact when you start to think about blocking specific connectors.
Okay, and these provide then a good level of visibility with specific or within specific environments, but what if you want a more holistic kind of cross-tenant view of activity?
You can do that too. You can build your own custom dashboards by taking advantage of the telemetry that the platform submits to the Microsoft Office 365 activity logs. And our Center of Excellence Starter Kit provides you these Power BI templates, which you can use to create cross-tenant dashboards that tracks your overall apps and flows. Here I can see the most active makers creating apps and what departments they're in and the most active departments. I can see the different environments that I've created. I can look at the different types of apps and trends over time. And I can even see what flows are being created. So both a combination of these out-of-the-box report and the cross-tenant dashboard template will allow you to very easily monitor the activity within your tenant. And as an administrator, you can have full visibility.
All right, so now you can see what's going on. But what level of controls then do you have in order to do things like manage access to resources and data?
There are multiple layers of security. At tenant level, everything is identity-based with Azure Active Directory, which offers native integration into the platform. This allows you to define conditional access policies for the platform. The next level is environment. As people build out their Power Apps and flows, you can scope permissions further by setting up environments to further govern access to data sources. You can determine who has admin-level privileges to perform admin operations within an environment. or who can create content. What is what we call the maker role. You can allow or block connection to specific data sources. And with data loss prevention policies, you can prevent the mixing of non-business and business data sources within a given app. At the layer beyond that, at the data itself, by provisioning common data service, you can control data access right down to the table and even field level.
So this then gets away from kind of that one-size-fits-all approach, and you can make sure that different departments then within your organization can access resources and data in a compliant way than as they build out new experiences and automations.
That's right. And that's where setting up environments is key. So let's go back into the Power Platform Admin Center. And I'll make this real for you by showing you how you would set up an environment. Now you can see here, I've set up a few environments already based on data boundaries. For example, I have geographic location and specific departments. I'll set up a new one. I'll click new. I'll give it a name. Next, as you set up the environment, you're presented with three different environment types. You have sandbox, where people can develop and test with limited impact on your resources. You have trial, which expires after 90 days for experimentation. Most often, you'll be setting up production environments. So I'll select that. I'll pick a location. You'll typically pick a region that is close to where your users will be. And then I have the option to pick a database, which typically means that you'll be provisioning the common data service. But I'll skip that for now. And I'll go ahead and I'll provision the environment.
All right. So then how do you define who has access then to this environment?
Well, once my environment is provisioned, I can see the details associated with it. And as an admin, I can perform different admin operations, such as managing and assigning users. I can define whether users should have environment admin privileges or whether they should have maker privileges. I'll go in and assign a maker role to a user. Now, something to point out here is that any user in Azure Active Directory is effectively a potential maker, but you can further define privileges. I'll search for a user, in this case, Sam, and you'll see that it is pulling directly from Azure Active Directory, and I'll add her. And now she can create apps and flows in this environment. Next, I'll go back in the environment and I'll add common data service. I'll keep the language as English and currency as US dollars. I'll go ahead and hit create. And once the common data service is provisioned, I have more granular control over what data Sam can access in this environment.
Great. So now you've got additional controls than if you tie your data to the CDS, but how do those controls then work?
Well, under settings, you can see all the additional capabilities that lit up as we provision common data service. To set specific data access controls, I can create a new security role. I'll give it a name, and then I have the option to define more fine-grained access rights depending on what that entity is and what I want the user to be able to do. I can decide if I want the user to read and write or delete data, etc. I'll allow Sam to create accounts. And I will allow her to read and write and to delete. You can see as I click these pies, they change look and feel. One click allows Sam to read accounts she has created herself. If I click twice, she can read accounts created by her business unit. And if I fill in the pie by clicking four times, she can read account records created by anyone in her organization.
Okay, so you've created the environment, you've kind of assigned a user to it, added the common data service database for more fine-grained control and security. But how then do you govern the access to the data that's living outside of CDS, for example, external data sources?
Well, the Power Platform gives you the ability to connect your apps to any data source. And we have more than 350 available connectors that takes care of the integration for you. And so at this time, we can go take a look at the policies to govern which users can access which type of data. So under data policies, you can define the data sources that a maker in a role can connect to within a specific app or flow. I've defined a few policies here for the different departments already creating apps. Let's take a look so you can see what it looks like. So by default, all connectors are added into non-business. But once you recategorize to business, you are able to isolate the specific data sources the user can connect to in a single application. Because this is the marketing department, I'll allow the user to access data from both Twitter and Common Data Service. But they cannot, in the same app, for example, connect to Adobe Sign or Act. I've also chosen to block SAP. This means that the user can't connect to this data source at all. Had this been the finance department I was creating a policy for, I would likely reverse the two. When I'm done with my policy, I can go ahead and define which environment I want to apply to. In this case, the environment is for my marketing department.
Okay, so there's really a lot here that I didn't even know about before. And this could be really good news, I think, for admins that are watching everywhere. But what's your team then working on next to even further this story?
We are continuing to build out capabilities in the Power Platform Admin Center, such as management controls for new resources that are being onboarded, as well as additional analytic views and government capabilities. Also, you'll see us do more in the area of alerting. Today, we publish sample scripts and flows for common alerts in through our Center of Excellence starter kit. For example, this flow helps you set up an alert to get notified when you see an app being shared with a high number of users. We also give you a Power Automate template for users to submit a business justification to create apps and flows, so you can potentially determine to set up an environment for them.
Okay, thanks so much again for joining us today, Julie. And also, to get access to the sample apps and flows and our cross-tenant Power BI dashboard template, check out aka.ms/COE starter kit download, and also join the Power Platform community to see how your peers might be using these capabilities. And that's at aka.ms/power-users. And of course, don't forget to subscribe to Microsoft Mechanics for the latest tech updates. That's the little time we have for this show. Goodbye for now.